To this new Sunday, this 27th day of August 2023. Welcome to you on this lovely Sunday morning. Can you smell it? Spring is in the air. We're nearly into the season of spring. I can smell it. I can see it. I can see leaves on trees, greenery returning, life in plants and flowers. The grass growing exponentially. Spring's coming and it's not too far away. It's a great time of the year. It's a fantastic time of the year. If you're here in Australia and you're a fan of AFL football, it means finals are coming. And it's just a really wonderful time to be alive and to appreciate the blessings of living full life, free life here. In a country like Australia, we shouldn't take those blessings for granted, of course. But it's great that you could join us here. We're blessed that you're here with us in this online service again this day at Sunshine Salvos. And we continue our look at encounters. We look at an encounter that Jesus had on a road. Lots of these encounters have been on the road. This one's a little different, however, because this one doesn't take place in the Gospels. And now you might wonder, well, how can that be that Jesus had an encounter with someone that's not talked about or written in the first four books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John? Well, this encounter that Jesus had on a Damascus road happened after he had ascended back to heaven. This encounter is a spiritual encounter. It's a mysterious encounter with a particular man who would shape the history of the Christian church in an indelible way. We look today, of course, at Jesus' encounter with Saul of Tarsus, who would become, of course, the Apostle Paul. We'll get to that a little later. But we have had a busy week at Sunshine Salvos this week, and we move into another week that's going to be busy. I'm going to talk a little about that in the announcements just in a little while through this service. But I want to acknowledge the fact that we gather, no matter where we are here in Australia, on traditional lands. Better to hear that acknowledgement and welcome to country from a First Nations voice. So again, I invite you to listen as we acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land where we're gathered here today.
Jingiwala Jimbalans, hello friends. Wherever you are in this great country, let us all honour and praise Navangali, our Creator God who formed this incredible land. As we gather today on different countries, we acknowledge the traditional custodians whom Creator God has entrusted custodianship over these amazing countries. We respect the enduring connection the traditional custodians have with creation and with the Creator. Everything we touch and everything we see, we appreciate their care and connection to this land. We remember our ancestors of the past and our elders who are present with us. Their stories and knowledge will be passed on for the generations that are to come. Remember that wherever you are standing today, you are standing on sacred ground.
And I add to that the commitment of the Salvation Army Australia Territory to the process of reconciliation and our support for a First Nations voice to be enshrined at the highest levels of Parliament. A call to worship. We begin our service as we always do with a prayer. And this prayer reflects on our eyes and that which we want to see. We want to see something new and fresh. We want our perspectives this day broadened to see God. Would you join with me as we pray? Eternal God, you are our heart's desire. And we ask this day that you would pour out upon your church the Spirit of your Son, Jesus Christ, so that dreams may be dreamt and that visions may be seen. Open our eyes, Lord, for your work among people in the community, so that we may join all those who with persistence and humility pursue your will in serving others in our world. Eternal Spirit, we pray this day that you would fill us with confidence and you would make us available to be your hands and feet in this world. Teach us to pray and help us, Lord, to hear the cries of God's children. Lord, we pray that you would help us to interpret the signs of the times and prepare us, Lord, for the kingdom of God each day and forever. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to sing a song that starts our worship well. Because why are we here? Why do we live? Why do we move and have being in God, who is the ground of our being? Why? Because we are here to worship. Worship through our singing, our praise. Worship through our living, our example. Worshiping God is the purpose of our life. Here we are to worship. Here we are to bow down and say this morning again that you're our God, so lovely, so worthy, so wonderful. It's a good reason to praise, and it's a good place to start our worship today as we sing together, "Here I am to worship."
To me.
continue to worship in prayer, offering up to God in our intercession for our community, for the issues within it, for the people we love at Sunshine Salvos, and for those who require prayer, offering our prayers to the God who answers prayer. Would you join with me this day as we pray?
Thank you.
Amen. Some announcements I have for today. We come to the last week, of course, in August, but we still have in our newsletter not a whole lot, to be honest, that relates to August, but we certainly will be moving into next month, which allows me to move into a couple of days from now. I'm thinking particularly of Wednesday, the 30th of August, just before September starts. Wednesday, the 30th of August, at Sunshine Salvos, one site, a fantastic group of charitable opticians and eye specialists called One Sight will be hosting a free day of free eye tests and glasses, if they're needed, for people within the community. And that means anyone. It's not about if you've got a Medicare card or a healthcare card, or even if you're a citizen or a permanent resident of Australia. Anyone can come to Sunshine Salvos this Wednesday, the 30th, to get their eyes checked for free and potentially get a set of glasses as well. That's certainly happening this Wednesday. If you're interested in taking up that offer, because let's face it, it's not cheap to get to an optometrist these days. When free things come along, you have to jump on them. If you're interested in getting your eyes tested this Wednesday, get in contact with myself or Captain Fung or at Sunshine Salvos on our number 9364 9335, and we'll make sure that you're booked in to see an eye specialist that day. That's this Wednesday, the 30th of August. I think from memory, we've got about already 75 to 80 people booked over the course of that day, but there's still space, there's still vacancies if you are interested to join us. Yesterday, the Ladies of Shine had a great movie afternoon, lovely movie, watching Mrs. Harris Goes to Paris. Probably not my kind of movie in many ways, but I know the ladies had a great time, and there's going to be more Shine activities, of course, in the coming month and towards the end of the year. But that leads me to blokes. Now, blokes, we've got an activity coming up this Saturday, and it's a fantastic activity just a day before Father's Day, Saturday the 3rd, I think it's the 3rd of September. This coming Saturday, blokes, midday, we have a space booked at the Smash Room. That's a place in Keilor that we've booked out. It's where you go, basically take a bat or a stick or something, and you bash things with it. It's an exercise of getting out all of the frustration, your stress, all of those things that are burdening you. Release the rage, release it all upon, you name it, objects, clocks, vases. It's a crazy place, the Smash Room. If you're interested in coming along, men, if you need to maybe get some Smash Room therapy into your calendar, then let me know. It's going to be a great afternoon. It's going to be a therapeutic afternoon. It's going to be a good sharing time, a good time of coming together with a common purpose and aim of looking after ourselves as men. It's an important thing to do. That's this coming Saturday. Blokes, get in contact with me. We'd love to have you come along. There are other announcements coming up for the rest of September, but I think I will leave the announcements there for today and talk about some of those things next Sunday. I think that's all the announcements I do want to make for today. I actually nearly launched into the usual thing I would say in gathered worship of now we are going to take up our tithes and our offerings this day, but that's a little hard to do, as you can appreciate, in an online space. I just forgot where I was for a minute. But we will continue to worship, and we're going to do that through another song. You'll know this song. Needs really little introduction from me. It's that famous song written by John Newton, Amazing Grace. But the reason I chose this song is because it reminds us again, particularly in this anthem, this hymn of the church, that we were blind, But through God's grace, his amazing grace, he has enabled our eyes to see things new, to have a divine perspective on things. That very much speaks into the encounter we're going to look at shortly. But first, before we do that, let's sing together. Amazing Grace. The scripture reading for today, and it comes to us in video form. Very dramatic one this day. It's nice and short, but it's punchy and it's dramatic. It's taken from a Jesus mini series movie, and it reflects the text of Acts chapter 9, where we find Saul of Tarsus traveling on the road to Damascus, and we have a look at this encounter, this powerful encounter that Saul has with Jesus, interpreted into motion picture. May God bless you. May he speak to you through his living word, through this video interpretation of Acts chapter 9 this morning.
Why do you hate Peter so much?
Because his claims are ridiculous. Because the idea that God would use him as an instrument of his will to spread the word of a new Messiah is ridiculous. How can people believe that the Creator would choose a simple fisherman to articulate his message? No. He would choose a man who knew a world outside of a fishing village. Not a man who spreads lies about an imposter, Jesus, but a man who can add beauty and power and truth to his message. A man like...
Saul. Saul. Why do you persecute me?
Who are you?
I am Jesus, whom you persecute.
No. No! What do you want from me? What do you want from me? What do you want from me?
Go into Damascus. You'll be told what to do.
May God add wisdom to the reading of his word and context and relevance to how we receive it for our life today. So I mentioned before in our announcement time, this coming Wednesday is a very important day at Sunshine Salvos. It's important because we are offering an opportunity for people in the community to have their eyes tested. Now, the Salvation Army, as a movement, as a church here in Australia, we have mission intentions. One of those mission intentions is very clear. It's about building healthy community. Having free eye tests, getting glasses if needed, is an expression of the Salvation Army being part of making this community healthier and building up people in the community in healthy ways. It's not just about spiritual health, it's about whole health, person's body, mind, spirit. And so we do an eye testing day free of charge because it fits in with the mission of the Salvation Army. We do it especially because we know that eyes are important. And we know that there are many charities around that specifically cater for people's treatment in terms of eye problems. I think of the Fred Hollows Foundation. I think of other similar charities that are set up to assist people, especially disadvantaged people, people in poverty, people living in developing countries, to assist them in treatment of eye conditions, blindness, even restoring sight to eyes that perhaps hadn't seen for many years. Because as Fred Hollows often says in his commercials, every eye is an eye. every single person who can receive appropriate treatment for an eye condition that helps improve their sight, improve their vision, that's worth it. That's a win. That's a fantastic result. And it's why the Salvation Army exists within our mission to build healthy community. And we do it this Wednesday at Sunshine Salvos through the provision of free eye tests. And it's going to be a fantastic day. If your vision is 20/20, or it's at least functional, and that might mean you wear glasses just as I do, multifocal glasses. But if your eyes work to a good enough standard that you would say that you function reasonably, then you appreciate the fact that sight is important and you don't take it for granted, or at least you shouldn't take it for granted, because I wonder how those of us whose sight is normal or relatively healthy, I wonder how we'd cope if suddenly our eyesight was taken from us. If all of a sudden the curtains closed and everything went black, and the only thing we could remember is the very last thing we saw. I wonder how you would cope with that. I know that happens to people. It's traumatic. It's awful. Sometimes it's irreparable. We look at an encounter today that involves a man on the road who had a mysterious otherworldly vision or epiphany, a revelation, a divine visitation of Jesus Christ himself. And following that amazing, unspeakable moment, that encounter that Saul had with Jesus, Saul was left blinded. We're going to look at that because I think it means something. I think it says something to us spiritually. I think it says something to us symbolically that's relevant even for us today. So let's get to the text. We're looking at Acts chapter 9. And we're looking at a person by the name of Saul of Tarsus. Of course, you know him better by the name of who he becomes, that being the Apostle Paul. And at the very beginning of Acts chapter 9, we learn something about Saul that's important. First verse of Acts 9 says this: meanwhile, Saul was still breathing out murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. We need to understand something about this guy, Saul of Tarsus. He was not, in terms of how we would think of a person following Jesus, a person who was inherently good, a person who was kind and gracious. That was not Saul of Tarsus. Saul of Tarsus was a zealous, self-righteous, legalistic Jewish man whose sole purpose and intention in life was to eradicate this new sweeping movement within Judaism that was called the Way, or the way of following the Messiah, Jesus Christ, Jesus of Nazareth, Jesus who was crucified by the Romans. Followers of the way of Jesus. And Saul's sole intention was to wipe out this growing movement, this growing, emerging church that Saul hated, that Saul persecuted and did not want to exist. Saul was zealous for the old ways of the law of Moses. Saul was a God-fearing, law-abiding Jew, and in his own words, in his letters, he would describe himself as a Jew among Jews. In other words, the highest expression of Jewishness that you could find amongst Jewish men. He was 100% committed to the purpose of defending God's honor, as he understood it, through the way of worshipping the God of Israel through the law of Moses. Saul was murderous. Saul killed people. He killed followers of Jesus, and he took delight in doing it. He wanted to eradicate this early movement, this growing movement that would become Christianity. This is who Saul of Tarsus is. It's interesting. There was a famous author, Alexandre Dumas. He wrote the famous book, The Count of Monte Cristo. He has an unusual but appropriate little phrase that he used in that book. It reminds me a little of Saul of Tarsus. The quote says something like this: hatred is blind. Rage carries you away. And he who pours out vengeance runs the risk of tasting a bitter draught. Rage and hatred is blind. It's a little foreshadowing for what would happen in this encounter with Saul, a rage-filled man, a man of hatred towards the disciples of Jesus, the ones who followed this new way, this new covenant way of Jesus Christ. And Saul is heading to Damascus to directly persecute followers of Jesus who are in their hidden, secretive communities, faith communities, house churches. He's going to Damascus to seek permission from local Jewish leaders in synagogues there in Damascus, which of course is modern day Syria. And he is going to drag back the followers of Jesus in chains back to Israel. If they even made it that far, more likely he'd probably just have them killed there and then. This man, Saul of Tarsus, was a persecutor. He was a murderer. He was a hater of the Christian way of Jesus Christ. And there he is on his way to carry out these nefarious, murderous acts in persecuting innocent, good people following Jesus. And who should accost him on the way but Jesus himself? In a way that we don't fully understand, in a way that is mysterious, it's ethereal, it's otherworldly, Jesus encounters Saul, I imagine with heavenly light, I imagine in some kind of shock and awe that Jesus appears to Saul. And we get it in the book of Acts as it's described in that chapter, chapter 9, where we read, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. Saul fell to the ground and heard a voice. And the voice said to him, Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you? Saul asked. The voice replied, I am Jesus, the one who you are persecuting. Of all people, can you imagine? Jesus appears to Saul and basically challenges Saul and says, why are you going after me? Why are you trying to kill my movement? Why are you trying to kill my kingdom? Why are you killing my followers? Why are you persecuting me? Because by persecuting the followers of Jesus, you are persecuting Jesus himself. And Saul, in his shock, in his bewilderment, in his fear, in his anxiety, says, who are you? Jesus says, I am Jesus, the one who you persecute. And we see, as we watch that particular video interpretation of Acts chapter 9, Saul crying out, "What do you want from me? What do you want from me?" Can you imagine Saul's fear in that moment? The whole world of his perspective crashing down. For so long he had staunchly defended the God of Israel, who he loved. Defending God from this new movement that he understood as a heresy, as something to be eradicated, this Jesus movement. And suddenly Jesus appears as the Son of God in his heavenly glory, and Saul is dumbfounded, dumbstruck, there in that moment, suddenly realizing that he has got it wrong all along, that the one who he is persecuting is actually the Son of God. Saul never believed it. He couldn't believe or conceive of the fact that someone who got around with fishermen, a mere carpenter from Nazareth, could even claim to be the Jewish Messiah, the Son of God. In that moment, Saul stands convicted. And he doesn't know what to do, and he cries out, "What do you want me to do?" Jesus says, "This is what I want you to do. I want you to go to Damascus. You're going to go to a street, you're going to meet some people there, and you're going to do nothing until they tell you what to do. And then it's over." And Saul's left in the dust on that Damascus road, wondering, "What have I done? What has happened to me? I can't see. My eyes are blinded. What am I going to do? What is my life? What is my purpose now? What just happened?" Can you imagine the state Saul would have been in? And we leave the text there. There's some important things that I believe are inherently a part of this story that really require our attention and require our consideration. The first question is this: we might wonder, why is it, of all people, that Jesus chose to reveal himself to Saul of Tarsus, such an enemy of the Christian faith, a murderer, someone who would be seemingly so unworthy, so ill-fitted to come into Jesus' presence, and even knowing who Saul will become? Why did Jesus choose Saul of all people? Was it simply the fact that Jesus saw Saul as such a threat to the Christian movement that he had to turn Saul over to the way of believing in Jesus? Perhaps there might be an element of truth to that. What I believe even more, though, is that Jesus sought out Saul because he saw in Saul all of the qualities that would be necessary to cause the Christian faith to explode within the world. He needed someone like Saul. He needed someone with passion. He needed someone with the zeal that Saul had. He needed someone who was single-mindedly relentless in his pursuit of achieving the goal that God had given him, his God-given purpose. Jesus needed Saul to become Paul. And I think it's amazing when I think about the way that God takes people, the very worst of people, and he transforms them into the best of people for his use, and uses all of those things that formerly were negative, things that were wholly against God's kingdom. He takes those things and then transforms them and uses them into things that will become kingdom building, kingdom equipping, kingdom growing. That's the experience of Saul of Tarsus, who would become Paul the Apostle. He took Saul, the most murderous, legalistic, narrow-minded, black and white, law-abiding Jew that you could imagine. He took that man and transformed him into the greatest missionary that the Christian church has ever had, for whom the Christian church owes such a debt of gratitude for the spread and the reach of the early church in and around Asia Minor and Mediterranean Europe. An incredible testimony to how God's transforming power can take the worst of men and transform them into the best. Saul was targeted by Jesus because Jesus needed Saul for everything of who Saul was. All the worst parts Jesus transformed into becoming the best. I think that is amazing, and we might even reflect upon our own life. Might not be as dramatic as Saul's conversion or his Damascus Road experience, but I think we can all look at ourselves in the mirror and look at those negative parts of who we are that God has transformed through his grace and his power and his love, transformed into more beautiful expressions of Christ-likeness. We can all relate to that in some way. God uses our qualities, the things we are born with, the people who we are, who he created us to be. He uses those things for his glory's sake. And Saul of Tarsus is one of the greatest examples we could consider in that respect. The other thing I want to look at, and I think really speaks to us, is this whole thing of blindness. This encounter that Saul had on the road with Jesus, and I don't know what it was. It could have been the heavenly glow, the flash of light, the glory of Jesus and his emergence, his presence there in his heavenly state. Something caused blindness to come upon Saul. He couldn't see. And it was for 3 or 4 days that he couldn't see. It's incredibly symbolic of the fact that Saul was blind. He was blind before Jesus made him blind. He was blind to the truth of Jesus. He was blind to the way of Jesus. And Jesus had to make Saul physically blind in order to broaden his perspective and see the truth, in order to live out the truth with purpose, to become Paul the Apostle, who God ordained and needed to be the leader of the early church. Saul needed to be blinded in order to see. Saul needed to be blinded in order to also be made to be dependent upon others. You know, you don't just walk from where Saul had that moment with Jesus as a blind person. You don't just walk there by yourself afterwards, blinded all the way to Damascus. That doesn't happen. Saul needed people to guide him. Saul needed to depend upon people. Saul didn't need to depend on people before. He was an independent person of influence. He could work and act in his own authority. Suddenly, Saul needed to rely upon other people in order to go to the place Jesus told him he must go. And Jesus didn't tell him anything else of what to do except to just go to Straight Street in Damascus, and that someone would meet him there and they would tell Saul what to do. Saul became dependent like a child, guided physically to getting to that place, looked after, having his needs attended to. Saul had to become humble, and he needed to be humbled in a dramatic way in order to refine his character for who God needed him to be. He needed to learn that the way of Jesus is not about self-importance or self-righteous action, but rather the way of Jesus relies upon community and love and depending on others and being vulnerable among others. Saul had to learn that. He learned it in the most dramatic way. He was guided to Damascus and looked after until eventually The scales fell from Saul's eyes and he could see again physically. Not only physically, but he began to see clearly spiritually. In order for God to transform Saul, in order to make Saul of Tarsus Paul the Apostle, Jesus needed to change Saul's perspective. And he did that in a very dramatic way. In order to make this character, Saul of Tarsus, see this way of Jesus, to embrace this way of Jesus, in order for that to happen, Jesus closed Saul's eyes. And he made him dependent upon others for God's glory and for Saul's own development and transformation. It's an amazing symbolic progression that happens in Saul's life. And I wonder how many of you might relate to that, those moments in your life where you couldn't see where things were going, that you couldn't see things and your perspective of things was clouded, perhaps blinded, that you were lost, just like the ancient hymn Amazing Grace suggests, that you were lost, but now, or suddenly you were found, that you couldn't see things clearly before, but now with God's help you can. I think in some way we might all be able to relate to that experience. Again, not as dramatic as the way that Saul did, but certainly it's unnerving and it's disarming to not be able to see things clearly, to not be able to get a sense of where we're going, to where we can't quite navigate well life. God is the way. His Son is the truth and the life. He's the light of the world who illuminates the pathway of our life and helps us and guides us in our journey, just as Paul was helped to Damascus. Of course, as we know, Saul would become Paul, changed, different in every way, even in name. He would become someone immensely mighty for God's kingdom and for the church. He would become the one who produced so much of God's inspired word that we have in the New Testament. He was the one who would become such a leader and example. It's not to say that Paul was perfect, by no means. But God did a transforming work in this murderous Jewish man's life that transformed him into the most gracious, loving leader and example of Christ-like service in spreading the gospel, the good news of the mission and the way of Jesus Christ in the world. Such an amazing transformation. Do you see God at work transforming you in your life? Again, maybe not as dramatically as Saul, but in the small ways, in the ways that he's just helping you see things better, in the ways that he's just at times in your life humbling you, bringing you to places where you have to be more dependent upon people. Do you see Jesus at work in and through your development, your growth, your journey? May God continue to guide you. May he continue to reveal himself to you. May he continue to open your eyes to see more of Jesus, to see more of the road ahead, to see more of your potential, your purpose, and the pathway of worshiping God and serving and loving others. May God help you to see things more clearly. May he broaden your perspective. May he give you divine vision to see things a different way. And may he continue to bless you on your journey as you encounter Jesus in unique and wonderful ways. Let's pray. We thank you, Lord, because you take the worst of us and can transform us into the best of who you want us to be. We see that through Saul of Tarsus, in how he was transformed into becoming Paul, the amazing missionary, leader of the early church. And yes, we also see it in ourselves. And we thank you, Lord, that you continue to refine us. You continue to purify us. You continue to work upon us in our own lives, making us better people, making us more loving, more gracious, more giving, and more serving of others. Lord, continue to mold and shape our lives into the likeness and the form of your Son, Jesus Christ, and bless us in our journey as you do that. May we be obedient to you. May we be attentive to you. May we open our eyes to see your way more clearly and be obedient to go your way. Bless us, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. A prayer of benediction I leave with you. May the love of God our Father, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and may the fellowship and unity of the Holy Spirit be with you this week as you continue to see Jesus and to see your journey in new ways, divine ways. Amen. Thank you for being here with us today. We'll be back here again next Sunday. It's going to be the last Sunday next Sunday, which happens to be Father's Day here in Australia. It's going to be the last Sunday we look at encounters. We're going to look at an encounter next Sunday, a father who was caught up in a very traumatic moment, a moment that shows his heart, shows his love and compassion, especially for his daughter. Next week, we're going to look at Jesus' encounter with a young father named Jairus. Until then, may God bless you this week. Bye for now.